Și vă invit respectos ca să deschideți împreună cu mine Sfânta Carte în Vechiul Testament. Vom rămâne în aceeași temă frumoasă care a fost abordată atât de frumos și sub ungerea Domnului azi dimineață și vom deschide la Deuteronom capitolul 1, unde voi citi începând cu versetul 1 până la versetul 5 inclusiv. I'll be reading in English mainly from the New King James Version, Deuteronomy chapter 1, starting with verse 1 through 5. The word of the Lord. These are the words which Moses spoke to all Israel on this side of the Jordan in the wilderness, in the plain opposite Suf, between Paran, Tophel, Laban, Hastaroth, and Dinazab. It is 11 days' journey from Horeb by way of Mount Seir to Kadesh Barnea. Now, it came to pass in the 40th year, in the 11th month, on the first day of the month, that Moses spoke to the children of Israel according to all that the Lord had given him as commandments to them, after he had killed Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt in Heshbon, and Og, king of Bashan, who dwelt at Astaroth in Edrei. On this side of the Jordan, in the land of Moab, Moses began to explain this law, saying, now, the passage that was read takes and happens at a very critical and important time in Israel's history. It was at this time when the people of Israel had finally made it to the point of getting ready to enter into the promised land. And the people that are involved in this great book called the Book of Deuteronomy are all vitally important. I mean, you have Moses, who was a persona of great importance in Old Testament thinking and theology and in New Testament thinking and theology. You have Joshua and Caleb and the team who didn't go along with the rest of the crowd. You have the memory in Deuteronomy of the men of war, the people who decided that they were too scared to trust God and move forward into the land. You don't have them. But you have the memory of them, and that's vitally important to have in the book of Deuteronomy and to acknowledge that we have those people present in the book of Deuteronomy. And then you have the children of Israel, those who were not part of the men of war and those who were 20 and under and now at this time are ready to enter in to the promised land. Now you have Moses, of course, who is basically preaching his last sermon. And he knew it. He knew that even though he was 120 years old and his vision was still good and his strength was still good, he knew he wasn't going to make it into the promised land and that the children of Israel would get to go in. Yeah, the rowdy crowd was going to get to go in and he wasn't going to get to. He knew that. And he is an important person. But before covering any details of all these other people, there is another more important person that we need to focus on before even considering to look at the book of Deuteronomy. And this other important person that we need to focus on is none other than Yahweh himself. And when I say Yahweh, it's the way that the name of the Lord is mentioned first in Deuteronomy. Yahweh meaning the Lord, Yahweh meaning God. Now, this Lord and this God was the same Lord and the same God 40 years before, when the children of Israel should have entered into the promised land. He was the same God. He didn't change. And it's important to know that the way God is presented in this first part, especially in verses 2 and 3 of the text that we read is the way that God is presented throughout the entire book of Deuteronomy. And for those of you who will read along and will study it, you will see that God is presented in a similar fashion in the book of Deuteronomy. But God isn't presented in the same fashion just in the book of Deuteronomy. God is presented in the same way in the entire Old Testament and in the entire New Testament. Why is that? Because the Bible tells us in Hebrews verse 13, chapter 13, verse 8, that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. You see, Israel's life, Israel's future, the future of those who are ready to cross into the promised land, depended entirely on them understanding not all of godliness, not all of God, because our mind is finite and we cannot understand all that God is. By definition, God remains God, and our knowledge is limited, and we have to humbly accept that. However, they had to know a minimum amount about God so that they could have a relationship with this God, so they could trust this God, and so they could reach the destiny, their destiny, of the promised land. Now, you see, things didn't change. The people on the other side were still stronger than the Israelites were. The cities were still fortified. They were armed. They knew exactly how to defend these cities. The giants were there. The Nephilim, if you will, were still present there. The children of Anak, these huge giants. And I think Israel was very realistic. In Numbers, in chapter 13 and 14, we read that when Israel compared themselves to these giants, they said they looked like grasshoppers. They were under no delusion. It's not like Israel got pumped up on steroids for 40 years. Manna didn't have steroids in it. These guys were still wimps. These guys were still weaklings. These guys were still outnumbered. These guys were still puny 40 years later. But something was different. Even though their God was the same, their knowledge of God began to grow. And Moses, in delivering his last sermon to them, in his introductory words, wastes no time in telling Israel, "Dear Israel, all of those who are here today and who very soon will go into the promised land and will fight the victory in the name of the Lord, all of you need to understand and need to know who the God is that you serve. We need to know who Yahweh is." Now, as a form of introduction, we all recognize that we're on the same road. We have a destiny. I have a place that I want to get to. I have a city that I want to live in. And it's not Seattle. And it's not Southern California. The city that I want to get to is the New Jerusalem. The streets that I want to walk on don't have crime and they're paved with gold. That's my destiny. And I know that that's where we all want to go, isn't it? Well, you know, if we want to get there, if we want to successfully navigate this road, we have to know and we have to begin to experience who this God, who Yahweh truly is for us today. Even though the happenings in Deuteronomy are ancient, it's like 3,500 years ago. Is this God still around? Is this God still in fashion? Didn't this God change? Isn't his mood different? No. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. His mood doesn't change. His grace doesn't change. His law doesn't change. He's the same. Praise be to him. And as such, along with Israel, along with Moses, along with all the saints, let us look at a few dimensions of who our God is and the character of the God of Deuteronomy, which is the same character of the God, our Lord, God Yahweh. God, dear friends, first and foremost, We have to recognize, just like Israel had to recognize, that the God that we serve is a God who is on our side.
Domnul și Dumnezeul nostru este un Dumnezeu care este de partea noastră.
God is for us. God is not against us. Now, you think, yeah, that's wonderful, Pastor. But what's new? This is new. It's not popular, even for Christians today, to acknowledge that God is truly for us. God is not some killjoy who is against us, who wants to clobber us, who wants to discipline us. Take a look at chapter 1, verse 2. And in it, you'll see that Moses is communicating to people who knew exactly what he was saying. People who had their parents who had gone through the Red Sea, or they themselves had gone through the Red Sea. And verse 2 reads, "It is 11 days' journey from Horeb, by way of Mount Seir, to Kadesh Barnea." Let me read it in Romanian. "De la Horeb până la Kadesh Barnea, pe drumul care duce la muntele Seir, este o depărtură de 11 zile." What does that mean? That means that Moses is telling the people of Israel, guys, do you remember God? Do you remember when you and your parents were in Egypt and were slaves? And do you remember that when your parents and your grandparents and your great-grandparents cried out to God and said, this slavery is too much. Lord, we can't take anymore. They're taking the straw from us. We've got to make bricks with this. We don't have time for recreation. We don't have time for family. We don't have time for absolutely anything. Do you remember how God miraculously raised up his servant Moses? Do you remember, people of Israel, how God intervened and rose up this person? And not only that, but after Moses came onto the scene and he began to deliver the people of Israel from Egypt, do you remember how God fought against all the foreign gods of Egypt? He took them one by one, one by one. Do you remember then that God was for you? Do you remember that Pharaoh said, we'll let you go? And then he changed his mind. Do you remember that he did that one time, two times, three times, nine times, and then God finally said, I've had enough? And do you remember that Moses commanded you all? Do you remember that Moses commanded you to sacrifice the Passover lamb and to take some blood and to put it on the doorposts? And to guard over your house and to stay indoors. And do you remember that the angel of the Lord, the angel of destruction, came and wiped out all the firstborn of Egypt? Do you remember that? And do you remember that your house wasn't touched? Do you remember that your kids weren't touched? Do you remember that? Now I ask you, Israel, whose side was God on then? Was he on your side or was he on the Egyptian side? And make no mistake, when Moses is reciting these words, these aren't an addition. These aren't just o umplătură artificială care nu și-are locul în Deuteronom, ba și-are locul. Și-are locul so that we can remember that God is a God who's on our side. Do you remember, Israel, when you're walking through the desert and you needed to start running? Because you heard that the Egyptian army was coming to get you? They again had changed their minds. And do you remember that in the nighttime there was a flame above? And you guys could walk at nighttime just as if it were day. Do you remember that? And do you remember that Yahweh, the Lord Jesus Christ, was in that flame? Do you remember that during the daytime, the cloud, the Shekinah glory came upon you and the Lord Jesus Christ went before you and walked before you? And do you remember that he was messing with the cars and with the trailers, if you would, of the Egyptians? Now, I ask you, Israel, whose side was God on when that happened? Was he on the Egyptian side? Or was he on your side? You see, Israel, all of these things have a purpose. They're not just there so God miraculously heals.
They're not just there so God miraculously works in your life. No, that's a secondary benefit. They're there so you can begin to trust. They're there so you can begin to have a relationship. Because God has greater things that are in store for you. And these things are just the baby steps to get you to the big thing. To get you to the heavenly Jerusalem. Now, you remember when you were in a crisis, Israel? You remember when you were at the Red Sea and you'd reached a dead end? And do you remember when people said, my goodness, were there not enough graves in Egypt to bury us? That sounds so Jewish. Kind of sounds Romanian too, doesn't it? Especially the old-timers. Us newer generation, we're a little bit more polite. We just go, you know, there. But hey, our parents would have said, hey, n-au fost destule sicrie în Egipt. Trebuia să murim aici, uciși de sabie. My goodness, they're going to murder us in our beds there. Well, do you remember what happened? Do you remember, does that trigger a memory for you, that when Moses struck the sea, do you remember the big wind that came? And do you remember how you walked as on dry land in the middle of the Red Sea? Do you remember that? And I ask you, whose side was God on then? Was he on their side or was he on your side, Israel? And Israel is remembering. You see, because the book of the law, and as it says here, let me make a short parenthesis. On this side of the Jordan, verse 5, in the land of Moab, Moses began to explain the law, saying, now for non-lawyers, and I assume that's most of you, law is a strange beast, isn't it? You know, before I went to law school, I thought that law meant thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not go over 65 miles an hour on the freeway. That's what I thought the law was. And I thought I was going to have to learn and memorize a bunch of statutes. I got to law school and I was sorely disappointed. I learned no statutes. You know what law was? Law is studying a bunch of stories. Human life stories. People goofing up. And then judges analyzing history, analyzing the history of a case, and formulating the law, applying the law to that case. That's Deuteronomy. Stories. The Bible is a bunch of stories, true stories. Live stories, stories that are so close to each and every one of us. Deuteronomy is one of the best stories in the world. And I invite you to dive in there and begin to look at the story. But what happens? As they're looking at this story, they're seeing a God who's on their side. They're seeing a God who, after they crossed the Red Sea, after they got to the other side and they saw all of Egypt and the armies of Egypt drowning in the Red Sea. They saw this with their eyes. They all sang a song of victory, didn't they? They said, mighty is our God. He's a huge warrior. Now I ask you, did a bunch of slaves who still had bruises and cuts and sores on their backs from the beating of the whip of the Egyptians, did these guys actually fight the Egyptian army? Who was the warrior? Wasn't it God? And I ask, whose side was God on then? Was God on Egypt's side or was God on their side? Now, Moses, freshly living these things and reliving these things, even though it's 40 years later in our particular context, tells them something. He tells them, listen, guys, you remember after you were dropped off on the shore? Did God just check out and say, make it on your own from here? Did God just say, listen, I got you this far, acum descurcați-vă, că v-am purtat destul, ați cârtit pe cealaltă parte acolo, n-ați avut suficientă credință în mine, acum mergeți cum vroiți voi. Is that what God said? What did God say? He said, listen, there's 11 days journey.
from Horeb, where the law came down, and God gave him the law, to Kadesh Barnea, 11 days' journey. Kadesh Barnea was the place that the spies went out from. Israel should have and could have started possessing the land within a few months after crossing the Red Sea. Now, for them, and Moses is telling them something. He's telling them, Israel, remember God is on your side. That has to be ingrained in your mind and in your brain and in your being. Because later on in life, you will have difficulties. You will meet giants. And you have to remember how God was with you years ago, how God was with you months ago, how God was with you last week, how God was with you yesterday. And the fact that you're still alive means that God is still with you. He's given you the grace. Don't you think it's time to trust God? I, for one, must confess, I have difficulty trusting entirely in God. And I think that if I were to ask for a show of hands, each and every one of us would say the same thing. You know, Israel had a tough time, even after entering the promised land, to trust God. Each and every one of us still has a tough time trusting God. That's why Psalm 124 was written. Now, if you'll open your Bibles to me so that we can see a live illustration of this. Take a look at what the final part of verse 2 says to us. Verse 2 of Psalm 124, the last part says, we'll start with the first. If it had not been the Lord who was what? Who was on our side when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive. When the wrath was kindled against us. Anybody suffered adversity? When men rose against us. When they swallowed us up alive. When you talk about swallowing up, it's the sign of a dragon, un balaur. Balaurul simbolizează toate temerile noastre, all of our fears, all of our terrors, the things that we're all afraid of. I have my fears. I have my dragons. I have the things that I'm thinking, God, I wish that that would never happen to me. You know, and as Christians, as people that has God on our side, look at what the psalmist says. When men rose up against us and they were just about to swallow us. Being a Christian, being part of God's children, doesn't mean that you don't suffer adversity. It doesn't mean that you don't have these fears. It doesn't mean that we're perfectly content and don't have tribulation. For in this world, you will suffer tribulation. În lume veți avea necaz, dar îndrăzniți, take heart, take courage. For we have our great high priest who's gone before us, and he's ready to show us the way. Now, that's the first part of the psalm. Take a look at what the next part of the psalm says in verse 4. Then the waters would have overwhelmed us, and the stream would have gone over our soul. What do waters mean? I've caught a glimpse of the disaster that's happening, I think, somewhere in Colorado. And you know, when a flood comes, when we were on our way to Palm Springs, on my iPhone, we got a warning. How about that? First day, you know, with a truck on the way to Palm Springs, beep, warning, flash floods. I'm saying, I just left the flash floods, for crying out loud, in Seattle. I'm coming to the flash floods here. This is odd there. But, you know, it was odd. You know what the warning said? Flash floods. Flash floods can come, and a dry land that is just secat de tot, it really doesn't absorb that great, and the floods just come right over it, just like in Israel. When the floods came, and flash floods symbolize sudden disaster. Sudden disaster. Something you can't prepare for. Today, you're just fine and dandy. I'm here at the pulpit. And hasn't it happened? You get off from the pulpit, and you don't know what's going to happen. We can get in the car. I might not make it back to Seattle. You might not make it home. We don't know. There's all these things that come to our minds. Well, the psalmist says, when the waters would have overwhelmed us. That means the waters came. The Christian is not absolved from these sudden floods, these sudden disasters. It comes upon us. Yes, it can. And it does. But the key to knowing God, the key to entering the promised land, the key to being truly faithful when these things happen, the key to understanding the God of Deuteronomy and the God of the Bible is that when all of these things happened, there's something else in the equation that we can't miss. Take a look at what that is in verse 1 and verse 2. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side. You know, Eugene Peterson in his translation says, if it had not been the Lord who was for us. God for us? God for me? What? Little grasshopper? Little Semenea? It was a speck of dust. God for me. When adversity comes, when the dragon comes and my fears come, and adversity come and evil and wicked men try to stomp me down, try to stomp you down. When the floodwaters come, God to intervene on my behalf? Does God really care? Or did God check out? Yeah, he got us saved, for crying out loud. He got us to the other side of the Red Sea, just like he got Israel. And then, as popular demand says it, all hell broke loose. No, all hell doesn't break loose because hell is not in charge. God is in charge. And take a look, at what verse 5 says. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Now, we're not just talking physical issues. We're not just physical beings. Israel wasn't just a physical glob of people. They were psychological, spiritual beings. There's the inner part of man. You know, and when all these things happen to us, and they do, we're all living proof that things happen. It's so easy to get bummed out. It's so easy to get depressed. It's so easy to get discouraged. It's so easy to throw in the towel and say, no more, God. I'm through. I'm through with the people. I'm through with the family. I'm through with everything. It's then that the wonderful hand of God comes to the rescue. When our faith is just barely hanging on, but it's still there. Doamne, cred! Dar ajută! Necredinței mele! It's then that the wonderful hand of God comes, and look at what the psalmist says. This is real stuff. I mean, these things weren't written just because some poet decided to pen and paper. Or a piece of leather and some other chernyala. No. What does it say in verse 6? Blessed be the Lord who has not given us prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Ajutorul nostru este în numele Domnului care a făcut cerurile. Now, Israel, do you see why it's important to know your God? Do you see that in the battles that comes before you, young people that weren't even 20 years old yet, those of you who have been born in the wilderness, in the desert wilderness, do you see why it's important to know in the first place, primul lucru care trebuie neapărat cunoscut, și nu doar cunoscut intelectual? It's not enough. You have to live it. Now I'm a little gray, but I'm not old. But I've lived a little. I've been through adversity.
And I know the devil wanted to destroy me. He wanted to kill my faith. He wanted to kill my family, like he wants to kill yours and yours and yours and yours that's watching. That's just the way it is. It's not going to change until we get to the New Jerusalem. Dear friends, physically, we're attacked. Spiritually, we're attacked. Emotionally, we're attacked. Psychologically, we're attacked. Well, Israel, there's still one thing you can depend upon, and I can depend upon when I'm attacked. You know what? It's four consonants. YHWH. Yahweh is for us. Dumnezeul nostru este de partea noastră. În drumul nostru spre țara făgăduită, spre țara promisă, avem un Dumnezeu care este cu noi, slăvit să fie numele Lui. And all the experiences that I've had and that you've had weren't just meant to be put somewhere on a shelf. Weren't just meant to be glory days. No, they were meant to become part of who I am. And part of what I feel. And you know, the psalmist also says, Cum voi răsplăti Domnului meu toate binefacerile Lui față de mine. See, when we come to worship, it's that type of a God we're worshiping. You've heard in the exposition of Numbers this morning, didn't you? That our God gives us the strength of an ox. Now, there's something else that an ox has. It's not just strength. I learned this from the Romanians. you Romanians already know. You know what the ox has? Romanians call it încă pățânare. Determination. God gives us the determination. Încăpățânarea sfântă să mergem mai departe. The strength to do it. Our God is on our side. Now, there are other things that we'll talk about at some other time, of course. Other key attributes of God that we must understand on our journey to the promised land, the journey that those in California are on, the journey that those in the north and Seattle are on, the journey that we're all on. We have to understand these things about God before we can begin to delve in and see Deuteronomy for the beauty that it is. I mean, you know, I just love the fact that we're in a Jewish synagogue. For crying out loud, look at the richness of this. Pardon me. This isn't just Jewish. This is my heritage. This is what we're about. This isn't just the Jews. This is valuable. I mean, look at this, for crying out loud. The scroll. This is what Deuteronomy was written on. There's so much richness and history and antiquity here that we need to value. But above all, let's remember that this book, it tells us about this God was on our side. Now, in closing, as you leave here today, would you start to ask God to bring back to memory all the wonderful things that He's done for you? And don't put them to just chance. Nu-i noroc, nu-i ca așa a fost să fie, nu. When the car didn't run you over, when you walked out of the accident unscathed, when you walked out of the accident with a broken leg and not dead, God was on your side. Dear friends, if God had been so mad and ticked at us that He wouldn't be on our side, we wouldn't be alive. God can execute judgment, and we'll see that later on. But the fact that we're here means that we still have a gracious God who still wants to hang out with us. He's always my God. He's always my Father. But He's also my brother. Frații mei sunt cei care fac voia Tatălui meu, care este în ceruri. I want to worship this God. I want to love this God. I want to give my life for this God. In Jesus' name, amen.